X Games, Apex Legends this weekend, Minneapolis, U.S. Bank Stadium. Arda and Glitter here to break it all down. We've had several segments like these, which you can catch at youtube.com/ESPN Esports. Now let's talk about the tournament itself. $150,000 prize pool, 20 teams across North America, Europe, and Australia, New Zealand. One of those teams that was invited was Team Rogue. You happen to be, now is it the assistant GM or assistant to the GM?
Assistant GM.
Got it. Okay, I just want to be sure. If anyone got the reference, good on you. All right, let's talk about the competition. By the way, there is a full Rogue preview on YouTube as well. So let's talk about overview of the competition. What are you looking forward to the most as we get into the weekend?
All right, so let's see. We've got two-day event, 20 teams playing, 15 were directly invited, 5 qualified in, 12 games over the weekend, 6 games per day. Not only am I so happy with the way they have set up the tournament, we've got really, really good weights when it comes to placement and kills. So you're going to get 1 point per elimination, and then you're going to be getting points based off of your placement, top 10 and higher. Or actually, it might be, no, it's actually 15th and higher, but to be fair, 11th through 15th only get 1 point, so it's not too much of a difference.
Yeah, exactly.
Right, and then
but
it goes up from there.
But you're a fan of the point system.
But the whole point being, we have seen nothing but kill races up until this point when it comes to Apex events. This is the first time where we're getting like a very nice weighted system where you're going to be rewarded for both your placements and your kills, which I think could potentially switch up some of the gameplay we're going to see out of some of those teams.
Yeah, let's talk about some of those teams, by the way. Sentinels, I will mention, qualified in the online qualifier, and the reason I'm bringing them up is because Booga, the Fortnite World Cup champion, is also Sentinel, so they could have a really good 2 weeks in BR. So they did qualify. A lot of the teams were invited, but when you look through the list, Misfits, NRG, Team Liquid, Solo Mid, Cloud9, T1, there's a lot of heavy hitters here, other than Rogue, which we talked about. Well, like I said, youtube.com/ESPN Esports. What are some teams that jump out at you?
My list is not going to include NRG.
Okay. Oh, sorry, Dizzy. Off the list.
Only because I think that this structure of this type of a tournament might throw them off their game just a little bit.
They're very aggressive.
They are very aggressive, and those kill race style tournaments cater to that gameplay perfectly, right? I think this style where they have to maybe rein it in a little bit and be really consistent with their placements as well to make an impact with their overall points might be a little bit of a struggle for them.
So you're thinking they're not going to place as well as we might think, because
right.
a lot of people would put NRG
at
as the
very
favorites,
top, right?
100%.
At the very, very top. And I certainly think that they're going to do well. I think they just might not do as well as the majority of people are expecting them to do. I actually think that T1 and TSM are going to do surprisingly well. Not only have they done very well in the Faceit series that they were a part of, I'm pretty sure they're very consistent in their scrims. So I think that they are definitely some teams to watch out for, and I think that a lot of people are also sleeping on Liquid.
Should we give a lot of weight to the Faceit series? I'm not discrediting the series. I'm saying this is a very different situation, right? This is a custom lobby. Faceit, they were just playing anybody around the world. So I'm wondering how much transferable clout there is to talk about the players that performed very well in the Faceit series that are coming here this weekend to X Games, because we could see some holes exposed in their game that we've never really seen before because they haven't faced this elite level competition.
Exactly, which is why I'm so excited for it. Are you kidding me?
Yeah.
I want to see some upsets. I want to see some underdogs, you know, show up out of nowhere. That's the fun of esports. Like, surprise me, somebody, anybody.
Well, in a situation like this where you have 20 teams of three, there certainly will be some surprises. But let's talk about some of these teams. I mean, Snipedown from Reciprocity is an example of somebody that could really shine in this tournament. What other teams are you saying, you know what, they have an opportunity to really jump up and make a statement here and grab the lion's share of the prize money?
I actually think one of the teams that qualified in, Nagano 1988, has a really good chance at doing well as well. They're one of the EU teams, but some of them have BR backgrounds that go back multiple games and LAN experience. And I think that that's something people need to take into account. I mean, you brought up Snipedown, you know, Halo, right?
Yeah.
So there's experience there that you know, kind of goes above and beyond just your BR experience, because if you've never played at LAN before, that's nerve-wracking. So just any professional gaming experience is going to put you one step above someone who's never sat in front of a massive crowd, because this is at X Games. This is not a small event.
Yeah.
You know, there's a lot of people watching you, and that's a lot of pressure to perform under. So anybody that has that under their belt is already going to be doing a little bit better.
Do you think that there's going to be, I mean, when we were both at the Fortnite World Cup, and I was talking with some of the competitors, and they were saying, yeah, I'd never envisioned playing in front of 20,000 people before. How much of that do you think is going to factor in here? We're at US Bank Stadium, where the Vikings play.
Exactly.
And now we're at X Games, and there's an Apex Legends event, and some of these people have not been in front of a crowd of 500,
exactly,
let alone thousands. So how do you think that's going to factor in?
I think it's a huge factor. I think that that's something that newer pro gamers have to struggle with, because a lot of them are used to sitting at home and playing by themselves with their teammates, or maybe in front of a stream, right? But that's not something that you can immediately really kind of appreciate. Like, even if you've got thousands of people watching you, it doesn't feel the same, because you don't physically see thousands of people standing there in front of you while you're playing. An arena of people, not to mention all of the concurrent viewership that's going to be going on top of it, it's a whole different ballgame, and I think that that might actually throw some people a little bit.
So you talked about it earlier, how previous iterations of Apex tournaments could have been just basically an elimination race, whereas this one adds a little bit of structure to it that might change that meta. So are we safe to say that not everyone's going to drop Skull Town? It's just going to be a firefight in the early stages?
So the way, and I'm not in the Apex scrims, but this is just how all pro scrims have functioned generally, is that every team kind of ends up with like a go-to spot. And out of respect slash fear for potential, you know, something going horribly wrong in the first 30 seconds, everybody just kind of accepts that, okay, that's so-and-so spot, right? So there very likely could be a team who's already claimed Skulltown, and it won't be the hot drop that it typically is. It might just be Team X's drop. Same thing, you know, with Bunker, maybe somebody that's just there, it's not the crazy rat race that it typically is. It might just be one team in Bunker. Mm-hmm. Especially, like, you need to think of how big the map is. So you've only got 20 teams on it. They easily can all have their own POI that is safe for them to land at, loot up, and kind of like start making their loot paths and their rotations from there without too much, you know, complications.
Yeah. One of the storylines that we typically see in BR competitions is region versus region, right? NA versus EU is a big one. That's always a popular storyline that's talked about. And there are three regions in this one: NA, EU, and Australia / New Zealand. So how much of that do you think we will hear this weekend, and how much will that motivate the competitors and the teams going into this tournament?
I think that's going to motivate them a lot. A lot of them are friends from previous games. They all know each other very well. They've been playing together now, whether it's in scrims or on stream together, for a while. And I think it's almost like that, it's like the loving, like the sibling rivalry of like, always, you know, anyone from NA is gonna be like, well, we're obviously going to do better. And then EU is gonna be like, are you kidding me? We're hands down leagues above you. And then Australia is gonna show up and be like, guys, you don't even know what's about to happen. You know, so it's the good banter. I think they all have pride in where they're from, and they all wanna show up for their regions.
Let's do predictions before we go.
Ooh.
Here. I'm going to play antagonist, and
oh,
I'm going to
say
Dizzy all the way. He's going to leave his opponents bewildered and dizzy, spinning. Their heads will be spinning by the end of the tournament, because NRG will be hoisting that trophy with ample energy. What say you?
Not that. No.
Wow.
No. Uh-uh.
Pick a team. If there's one team that you're going to say, you know what, they have the best chance to win here.
And I can't pick my team, just to remove bias?
You would pick Rogue. But if you can't, yeah, just remove the bias. Let's say Rogue is your first pick, but if not Rogue. Mm-hmm.
TSM.
TSM. Why?
It's a gut feeling. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Because it's a really tight toss-up for me between T1 and TSM. I could be way off here, but I think that they're going to be really strong.
More videos are available at youtube.com/ESPN Esports and, of course, Twitter, ESPN_Esports. We will be there all weekend. Round of applause for Dizzy, your winner. Ah, you're clapping. That was good.